Hello everybody and welcome to the Crafty Ninja channel. I start by taking a 16 ounce Plump tumbler and I add Sculpey ultralight to the top and the bottom to kind of make it look like a snowman. Rounder at the top and rounder at the bottom. Smooth it out as best as you can. You'll want your ultralight Sculpey to cover at least maybe a third of the top of the tumbler. Once you have your top snowball finished, you'll want to do the same thing to the bottom of the tumbler. still smoothing it out as best as you can. Then I take a little extra ultralight to add to the middle of the cup to blend the two snowballs together. Trying to get it as smooth as I possibly can. When you're finished, you want to bake it at the recommended instructions on the packet. Now that you have your cup baked, we're going to add the Super Sculpey on top of it. I like to roll my Super Sculpey out with a pasta machine to get it to an even smoothness and then apply it directly to my cup. You see me here applying a little bit of liquid Sculpey to the cup just to help the Super Sculpey stick. While you wrap your Super Sculpey around the cup, be sure to get as much air pockets out from underneath the clay as you possibly can. Any left air pockets can result in some cracking of your clay, and you want to avoid that as much as possible. If you miss any later after your cup is completely wrapped, you can poke a hole in it and then just push the air out. Once you get your clay completely wrapped around the cup, you're going to cut off the excess and blend it as best as you can. If your seam is a little uneven, similar to mine, you can always add more clay if you can't stretch it enough to blend the seam together. I also like to cut off the excess off the top of the cup and then slowly blend it upwards to make the top of the rim a little bit thinner. Once you're happy with the top part of your cup, you're going to do the same thing to the bottom and completely wrap it in super sculpey clay. Being sure to remove as much air as you possibly can and to blend the seams as best as you can as well. You'll also want to trim any excess off the bottom of your cup as evenly as you can with the bottom of the cup to prevent any wobbling. If you do notice any wobbling after you baked it, you can always sand it down later. Thank you. Now I'm just blending the seam at the bottom of the cup as best as I can to make a smooth transition. Now that we got our base layer of clay on the cup, we're going to roll out some clay for the snout. I'm not entirely sure how much clay I used. It might have been about 2-inch in diameter piece of clay, and then I cut it in half. You can always add more if your snout is too small, but you're just going to apply it kind of close to the bottom of your top snowball, and make it as wide as you possibly can, and then you're gonna pull it to kind of a point, blending your seam in to the base layer of clay. Okay, now that we have our snout in place, we're going to add a little tiny piece for the nose. I think I did a 3/4 inch piece of clay, I'm not entirely sure, but I create kind of a little round nose, or maybe it's more of an oval shape, just at the tip of the snout. You'll also want to blend in that seam just enough so that it is attached to the snout. If you can't use your thumbs, I use my silicone pointed tip tool to help blend the seam in. Now we're going to do the eyes. You're just going to roll out a small oval-shaped piece of clay for each of the eyes, and you're just going to put it just on the outside of both sides of your snout. If it's too big, you can always adjust it. Or if it's too small, you can make it bigger. Just get it to the size that you'd like the eye to be, and then place it on both sides of the snout. I wanted my badger to have a little tiny bit of a smile, so I took my my angled pointed tip silicone tool and created just a little bit of a smile. You don't have to use a silicone tip tool, you can use a sewing needle, you can use a toothpick, whatever tool you need, just create just a little bit of a smile in the bottom of the snout. I didn't record the ears apparently, but basically all you need to do for those is to roll out some clay, make them into two flat half circles, and place them on opposite sides of the cup, kind of near the top of the head. If you are going to have the sorting hat topper, please keep that in mind. You don't want it to go too far up, it can affect how well your hat topper will sit on the cup. Here I'm just smoothing out a few spots on my cup that were a little uneven. Now I'm working on creating the little tufts of fur right underneath the ears, and you're basically going to take two small triangles and you're going to place them just under each of the ears, and then you're going to blend it as well as you can into the base clay. Here I'm just creating little details at the end of the tufts of fur to create more of a fur texture at the ends. Now I'm just repeating the exact same thing on the other side, just a little bitty triangle right below the ear, and then blend it in well, and then create the little fur textures at the ends. Now I'm adding the legs. For the legs, or the front legs, I added, just rolled out two snakes of clay, one for each leg, and I apply it basically on both sides of the snout, on the bottom part of the body, and I just blend it in to the base clay. Be sure not to make it too thick or it might look a little off. Thank you. Then I repeat the same thing on the other side. I know I didn't show this part very well, but basically for the feet, I just push a little bit of clay down to the bottom, and I start creating just a little bit of excess clay that I start to push up to create basically a small paw. I really wanted my badger to not have too big of feet, so it's not sticking too much off of the leg. But you just want to make it big enough that it's obvious that it's a foot. I also like to set my cup down on my workspace to make sure that it is as even with the bottom of the cup as I can possibly make it, so it doesn't wobble. Okay, here I am making the back paw, and my back paws were facing frontwards. So I took basically an oval-shaped piece of clay, and I just formed it to basically look like a paw as much as I can. I also kind of curled it just slightly. Then I take my angled silicone tip tool, and I just create some lines in the top of the foot to create the illusion of the toes for the foot. Then I just roll a few balls of clay to create the little pads on the bottom of the feet. Smaller for the toes and then a bigger one for the center of the foot. Here I'm just placing the paw next to the front paw, and then I blend it into the base clay. I decided a little bit later to add some more clay to create more of a raised element for the back leg. You're just gonna basically cut out maybe a half circle worth of clay, as big as you want the back leg to be, and then you're just gonna blend it into the paw. Then, once you finish this side of the leg, then you're going to do the other leg exactly the same way. for the scarf, I had rolled out and cut a certain amount of clay to block out where I was doing my scarf. This is not necessary, and to be honest, I wouldn't recommend doing this because it's very hard to blend into your knit stitch clays. So I would not recommend doing this. This was just for me to help block out exactly how big I wanted my scarf to be. But that's just to show where the scarf is going to go. For the actual knit stitch, I just used my clay extruder to push out several strands of clay that will be used to be twisted to create the knit stitch. For the scarf stitches, I twist two strands of clay and I twist it away from me to create the first half of one row of stitches. And I place it at the edge of where I want my scarf to be. Then I cut off the excess to however long I want the end of my scarf to be. Now I'm going to take the same strands of clay and I'm going to twist it towards me to create the second half of the stitch, row of stitches. You want to be sure you do it away from you and then towards you to create that V stitch that the knit stitch would look like. Now I'm starting the second row of knit stitch, and I twist my two strands away from me for the first half of the stitches. Then I place it directly next to the first row of stitches, trying to keep my stitches as even as I possibly can. This is my first time doing it, so my stitches weren't completely even, but you'll want to try to get it as close to even as you can. Now I'm taking the same strand of clay and I'm twisting it towards me to create the second half of the knit stitch. Then I just repeat the process until I have four rows of knit stitches, or until it's as wide as you would like your scarf to be. But you'll want to make sure that you've done it an equal amount of times. So I've twisted strands of clay 8 times for 4 rows of knit stitches. Thank you. once you have the part of your scarf that's going downward, you're going to start doing the top part that wraps around the neck. And you're just going to repeat the exact same process you did for the small piece of scarf and just do it all the way around the whole neck. Twisting it away from you, and then doing the next strand, twisting it towards you, until you've got an equal amount of strands that match the width of your bottom part of your scarf. Then you want to try to blend the two ends of the strands together as best as you can. I have not perfected this. I can make it look decent, but if there is a tip or a trick to do this more efficiently, I would be happy to hear it. But you just want to blend it as best you can to make it look like it's completely wrapped around your neck. Then you repeat the same thing, but with the strand going towards you as you twist, and try to line up your stitches as best you can, going all the way around the neck. And you'll do this until you have four knit stitch rows. This is where I decided to add a little bit more dimension for the back legs. I just add a little bit of clay, smoothing it as best as I possibly can, and creating kind of a little bit of a hill with this clay to create the back leg. Smooth it out as best as you can, but we will be adding some fur texture to it so it doesn't have to be completely smooth. I use my silicone tip tool to help blend in the edges as best as I can. Also, doing my best to make sure that my clay does not go below the cup edge so that we reduce the chance of wobbling. The second time I made this, I added the back leg part that I'm doing here first before I added the paw. I would recommend doing it that way instead of the way I did it, because it's easier to get the right position for the paw after you have your back leg in place. Here I'm adding the texture to the fur, and I use my angled tip silicone tool and basically just create lines in my clay to create that look of fur. For the legs, I gave it a little bit more of a curved look, whereas the rest of the body, it's pretty much just up and down. I apologize that some of the details on this might be a little bit blurry, but I'm basically just taking my angle-tipped silicone tool and going up and just pulling straight lines to create the texture of the fur. Also on the leg, giving it just a little bit more of a curve to make it look a little bit more like the leg would look. Also doing the paws on the back side of the paw and on the front. For the face, you want to think of the nose of the face as like the center of the sun, and the fur is going to go out like the rays of the sun would. So it's all going to start from the nose, and it's going to kind of go outward away from there. Some parts are going to go upward, some parts are going to go to the side, but think of it as like the rays of the sun going around the nose. Also being sure to get the back. Now I'm just rolling out some clay for the tail. You're going to roll out a snake of clay. You're going to make it kind of a triangular shape and a little bit thinner at the base because we're going to blend it into the bottom of the cup going upwards to create the illusion of a tail. You'll want to make sure that you're blending it just a little bit at the bottom of the sides as well as the base of the tail. You can use your silicone tip tools to also help blend it in where your thumbs can't quite reach. For the texture of the tail, you're basically going to do the exact same thing you did to the little side face tufts of fur and just create the illusion of fur with your silicone tip tool. Originally, I had removed the tail to add the texture to the fur before I added the tail back on. That's absolutely not necessary. You can just texture it all together at the same time. But here I am just texturing the tail to give it the fur texture. Once you are happy with the texture of your fur, you're going to put it in the oven for the temperature and the time that is said on the back of the instructions of your clay. Now that our badger is baked, we're going to paint it. We're going to start with the white And we're going to paint the bridge of its nose white, just on to both sides of the eyes. Then we're gonna paint the mouth and the sides of its face white, up to the tufts of the fur on the sides. And you're gonna be left with two like triangle spaces that kind of create a V that will be painted black later. Now we're gonna add the black. Now for the fur, I kind of made it a slightly dark gray because I wanted the eyes and the nose to be pure black and I wanted them to stand out. So I kind of mixed a little bit of white with my black just to tone down the black a little bit so that my eyes and nose will be a little bit more black comparatively. But you're gonna paint this dark gray blackish color in the two V sections right where the eyes are up to the ears. And you're gonna repeat the same thing on the other side. Just think of like two slices of pie of black on both sides of the face. Thank you. Now we're going to paint the rest of the fur the same dark gray blackish color that we painted the face with. The back of the head, the tail, the legs, the body is all going to be the same color. The only white spots are going to be right on the face. Thank you. Now we're going to paint the eyes, the nose, the inside of the ears, and the pads of the foot the dark black color. Now for these smaller details, I like to use a high flow acrylic paint. It's a little bit thinner and easier for me to paint cleanly. That's just my preference. Obviously you can just use regular acrylic paint for that if you prefer. I already had it on hand and I just realized I really like the thinness of the paint, made it easier to paint the smaller details. And they have a tendency to be a little bit more opaque than some other paints. If you feel inclined to, you can also add black to the mouth, the little smile that we had created to really make that stand out. I had intended on doing that, but I didn't. I did that on a later cup. But that's a personal preference. If you don't want it to stand out, you don't have to. But it would make the smile a little bit more noticeable if you paint it black. Thank you. So now we're going to paint the scarf. Now for the Hufflepuff, the scarf is yellow and black, so you'll want to start with the lighter color and paint your scarf yellow. If you want to skip this step, you can also use colored clay for the scarf instead of painting it. It is a little bit easier. I don't typically use colored clay very often, but for the scarves it does make it a little bit easier to do. So if you want to skip that step of painting the scarf, the base color, you can always just use a colored clay and then paint your black stripes on later. For the black stitches, I painted a row of black stitches of two. So in each row there will be two black stitches, and you do that all the way to the bottom of your scarf. Because this is a lot of detailed painting, I did use the high flow black paint to paint it, because it was a little bit easier to do a clean, to paint the stitches cleanly. Keep painting two stitches all the way down to the base of your scarf. The way I spaced out my black stripes was I did two stitches of black, and then I counted three stitches, and then two more stitches of black. So there should roughly be about three stitches in between each stripe of black. If you didn't line up your stitches perfectly, that might not be accurate, but you still want to space them out as evenly as you can. Mine was not spaced out as well as I would like, but this was also my first one. Thank you. Then you're just going to keep doing your black stripes until you've gone all the way around your scarf, and then you'll paint the stripes on the lower part of your scarf. Thank you. Now we're just going to do the same thing to the lower part of your scarf. You're going to count 2 stitches and you're going to go all the way across to the other side of the scarf. I did paint these little tiny stitches because I was trying to keep my stitches even. It was unnecessary and you don't have to do that unless you want to. I should have placed my black stripe on this part of the scarf 1 stitch lower. Another thing I did forget to record was to do the little white dot in the eyes. The way I did that was I just took a ball tool and I just dipped it in some white paint and just gently dabbed it on the corners of the eyes. You also could skip that step if you really don't want the little white dots in the eyes. That's just what I like to do because it gives it just a little bit more of a personality. Here's our finished Hufflepuff Badger. Please stay tuned for the Sorting Hat Tumbler topper that goes along with this cup. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see tutorials for the other Hogwarts House animal cups, or would like to see any of my other 3D designs, subscribe to my channel. See you next time, and remember to stay crafty.